Hi guys, welcome to Kefi Blossom Designs. Today I'm going to talk about a sewing technique called as foundation paper piecing. Meet Tori. Tori is a patchwork block made by using this technique. The finish that you get using this method is extremely satisfying, as almost always you can achieve perfect points. The process of foundation paper piecing starts with its paper pattern. It can be a digital pattern or a physical pattern. In case if you wish to make Tori, you can find her pattern at my Etsy shop Kefi Blossom Designs. I will provide the shop's link in the description below. In case of a digital pattern, the first thing you need to check are the printing instructions. In this example, the patterns have to be printed on A4 sized sheets and at its actual size. Do not select fit or do not custom the percentage. After printing, you will find these reference squares in the physical copy. Measure these reference squares to verify if the pattern has been printed at its 100% scale. After printing, the next step is to cut out the different sections in the pattern. For the purpose of this video, I will be elaborating on section D of the pattern. To cut the sections out, use this outer thick gray border as your guide. While cutting on any lines, I usually prefer to cut on the outer sides of the lines. Now, Kefi Blossom design patterns might be a little different compared to the other patterns you have used. This third border can be one of these differences. Each section acts as a blueprint for the pattern. You will notice that all sections have subsections with alphanumerical labels. In this case, they are D1, D2, and D3. These labels actually provide the order in which we need to stitch, and the shapes of the subsections tell us about the shapes and dimensions of the fabric required. And the lines forming these subsections are the stitch lines. Now, following the sequence, let's identify these stitch lines. We will start from D1. The line common to D1 and D2 is the first stitch line. Next, we move to D3. The next stitch line will be this D3 line that is common with the previous stitched sections of D1 and D2. The next stage is cutting the fabrics. Since this is a small section, we can fold on the stitch lines, place it on the fabric and just cut. I prefer another method in case if we have a more complex section. In this method, we need to take two prints of the pattern. Now, instead of taking a second print, you can use a tracing paper and trace out the sections. Now, refer the pattern in which we will find a pattern key. We can see that D has three subsections. We will start cutting out these subsections in the reverse sequence. First, cut along the D3 stitch line and then along the D1 and D2 stitch line. Next, we refer back to the pattern key. Now, the pattern key is a table that gives details of these subsections, like the fabric colors used and the design parts. Now, what are design parts? You can find this diagram in the pattern that names all the parts in the final output. So here in the key, D1 and D3 belong to the background, which is this part, and D2 belongs to the beak, which is this part. Next, you will notice there are symbols on the pattern. These are color symbols. In the pattern, you will find a color scheme table. Each color has a corresponding symbol that are printed on the subsections. So for D1 and D3, it's this symbol, which means dark gray. And for D2, it's this symbol, which means pink. Let's start by cutting out dark gray fabric for D1 and D3. Here, I'm placing the dark gray fabric wrong side up. And I will place D3 print side up on the fabric. This means that the fabric and the pattern pieces are kept wrong sides together. And now I will cut around D3, keeping a seam allowance of about 1/2 inch. In the beginning, you can cut bigger pieces until you get comfortable with this technique. I will repeat the process for D1 with the same grey fabric. And for D2, I will use a pink fabric. After cutting the fabric, we move on to the sewing part. Here is the fabric piece that was cut for D1 and a printed pattern. Flip the pattern over so that its printed side is facing down. Now take the fabric piece and place it on the pattern in such a way that it covers subsection D1 and extends further beyond D1 to account for its seam allowance. You can cross-check the placement of the fabric by holding this arrangement against a light source. Here, I'm using the phone's light. You can also hold it against the sunlight or any light source in your room. To avoid the fabric from moving, you can pin it in place or just glue it. Here, I'm using a regular glue stick. For the next stage, we will need a cutting mat. As mentioned earlier, the line between D1 and D2 is the first stitch line. Now take a regular card paper or any other stiff paper and place it along the stitch line. Now fold the paper along the stitch line and remove the card paper. Next, take a ruler and place it 1/4 inch or 3/8 inch away from the folded edge of the paper and cut the excess fabric out. Now unfold the paper and place this arrangement with the fabric side facing up. Next, we will take the fabric piece that was cut for D2. Place it right side down on D1 along the edge that we just trimmed. If you want, you can pin the fabric in place. Now flip this arrangement and stitch on the first stitch line. You will notice that the stitch line is extended with a dotted gray line. This is the seam allowance for this stitch line. Start stitching from this point till the end. Here, I have backstitched at the dotted line and at the area between the middle black border and the inner border. Next, we will unfold the pink fabric and give it a good press. Now, we will go back to our cutting mat and place this arrangement paper side up. As mentioned earlier, the next stitch line is this D3 line. Take the cardstock again and place it along the next stitch line. Now fold the paper along the stitch line. You will notice that since the previous stitch line gets extended, it is not convenient to fold the paper. All you have to do is gently pull the paper away from these extended stitches. Sometimes while pulling the paper, you might rip the paper. A simple solution for this is a bit of sellotape. Just stick it over the rip and you will be good to go. As we did for the previous stitch line, take the cardstock again and place it along the next stitch line. Now fold the paper along the stitch line and remove the card paper. Take the ruler and place the ruler 1/4 inch or 3/8 inch away from the folded edge of the paper and cut the excess fabric out. Now take the piece we cut for D3 and place it right side facing down, matching its edge to the new edge we just cut. You have to be careful as to how you place the next piece. If you keep it this way, stitch it and open up, it does not cover the entire D3 area. You will have to move the fabric around in order to get the correct placement. However, there is one technique that we could follow to avoid this mistake. You can fold the pattern on the D3 stitch line again and place it down. You will notice that parts of the D3 subsections are visible. Now place the D3 fabric along the newly cut edge in such a way that it covers all the visible sections of D3. You can flip and check again. This is the D3 subsection, and you can see the fabric that we just placed covers the entire portion of D3. Now unfold the paper, and if you want, you can pin the fabric in place. Next, we will stitch along this D3 stitch line. Again, I have backstitched between the middle black border and the innermost border. Now open up the D3 piece and iron it out. Next, we need to trim the excess fabric around the section. Before I trim the section, I usually glue down the parts of the fabric that might have a tendency to displace. This helps in keeping the fabrics in place till I'm ready to assemble the different sections. Now I'll trim this section down using this middle black thick border as my guide. Now section D is ready and we can move on to assemble the different sections of the pattern, for which we will have to refer back to the PDF pattern. Now in the pattern you can find detailed steps with diagrams explaining how to join the different sections. Here in step 1, you have to join section A with section B, and in the next step, you have to join section C to the combined unit of AB, and in the third step, we have to join D to the combined unit of ABC. So here I have D and the assembled ABC, and after I join them, it looks like this. To understand the process of assembly in detail, I will directly jump to the last step, which is this. You can notice that some points are marked with circles. These circles are in pairs of same colors, and the points in the same colored circles have to be matched up while sewing. For example, this point belonging to A10 has to be matched with this point belonging to E1. To make the process easier, only the subsections useful for assembling are featured in the diagrams. To see this process in detail, let's look at the physical pieces. These are the two final parts required for the final assembly. We will flip them over and look closely. For reference, on the left side is the final assembly diagram. As mentioned earlier, this point of A10 and this point of E1 have to be matched. For convenience, I am marking these points on the paper pattern. The next set of points to match is this A6 point with this I3 point. Again, I will mark these points on the physical pattern. And the next ones are this E3 point with this D3 point. And finally, this I9 point with this A14 point. For the next part, I will need some folded fabric. We will place one of the parts print side up on this fabric. And I will take some sewing pins and push them through the points that we just marked. We have to make sure that the pins are put in perpendicularly. I will repeat the process with the other piece also. Make sure that the points are put in perpendicularly. Now we will take both the parts with the pins still in them and we'll place one part over the other in such a way that they are right sides facing together and with the pinned sides lined on the same side. Now I will pick it up and starting from one set of points, I will carefully take out the lower pin. You will notice that after taking out this pin, it leaves a hole in the fabric. Now I will hold the top pin and without removing it, insert it into this hole. I will repeat the same process for the next set of points. Again, I will pull the lower pin out, which will leave a hole on the fabric. I will take the top pin and insert it into this hole. I will repeat the same process for the other two set of points also. After pinning all the points, I will take these clips and clip the sections. I will start by clipping the sides of the pins first. After clipping, we can take the pins out and I will stitch these parts together, keeping this innermost gray border as my guide. After the final stitch, our block is ready. And now this block can be converted to a cushion or a quilt or anything we like. If you like this block, you can find the complete pattern at my Etsy shop, Kefi Blossom Designs. I will give the shop's link in the description below. Currently, there are a few patterns in the shop and I will talk about them in my future videos. So stay tuned and please like, share and subscribe. Thank you.